because of which value of the x was. Okay? And once you get the optimal value function, you know how to act. Basically, you just, as I said, you look at your neighbors and see which is the most, which is the action that I should take such that I would get the expected highest backed up value. Okay? That's about value functions. Actually, there are a bunch of improvements to value functions. I just quickly mentioned that one important thing is you don't have to actually do priority, you know, the synchronous updates. You know, the way we did the value update is everybody changes their value, then everybody changes their value again, then everybody changes their value again. It turns out that you can actually prioritize who changes, updates their value when. You can, for example, look at how much the value of a state has changed in the previous iteration. And the ones whose value has changed a lot, you update them first. Because if they're changing a lot, that means some interesting messages are coming from their far neighbors. And so they're more likely to change more. The guys who haven't changed much, you can update them later. If you do this, and if you still, as long as you update everybody infinitely often, if you update the ones which are changing faster earlier, then you can show that's what the priority is going to be. And the priority is sleeping, you can almost see intuitively that that will converge faster. Okay? The other very interesting thing is in the normal value update, we basically assumed that everybody uses the values of their neighbors from the previous iteration. But if you're no longer doing synchronous update, then there is no such thing as iteration. So somebody might have changed, this state might have changed its value 15 times from the start, whereas its neighbors may only have changed their values like 7 times, 9 times, and 20 times. What you do is when you look, you just look at the current values estimates of their neighbors. That means you are essentially combining values from different potential iterations with respect to the original value iteration of them. If you do that, it turns out actually it's better. Because, you know, before you change your value, if your neighbor already realized that they're much richer than you thought they were in the previous iteration, you might as well just take that into account in updating your value. So that turns out to be a faster way of updating value iteration. One last thing I want to mention, and then we'll go back to next class to talk about this, is one very interesting thing, a strange thing, we have been doing is we wanted what? What do we really want in MDBs?
Optimal policy.
Optimal policy. How many optimal policies are there? Only A power S. I'm sorry, how many policies are there? Sorry. How many policies are there? A power S. It's also, by the way, not clear that there's only one optimal policy. There can be many optimal policies, but they only have unique optimal value function. All of them basically get back to the same value. So here is an interesting question. It looks as if we are wasting our time in some way. We are searching in the space of infinite number of value functions, trying to find the optimal value function, when you really what you needed to do is to find the optimal policy, which is in a discrete space of only A power S. So why are you searching in the value function? Why not search directly in the policy? So in the case of policy iteration, what you do is you start by initializing, instead of initializing a value, you just start initializing a policy. So you start the, you know, start the computation by initializing for everybody. You do this action, you do this action, you do this action. So you're given an random policy. Right? Now having given the random policy, I can then compute the value corresponding to that policy using these linear equations, which either I can do directly by solving the linear equations or by just doing a value update without max a few times so that the values of the states are closer to what the policy says their value should be. So now I started with a value function. I'm sorry, I started with a policy. I converted it into a value function. Then I do the circular reason. Now that I have a value function, what should my policy be? And you must be thinking, well, that would be the policy you started from, right? No, it doesn't have to be. In fact, after you compute the value of a policy, then if you take the greedy policy with respect to that value function, that would likely be a different policy. Because, why? Because in some sense, there are multiple ways of thinking about, one of which is that value tells you the global value of solving, you know, using this policy. Okay? And so in some sense, it can actually have local inconsistencies in the policy function, and you can reduce those local inconsistencies by essentially going from the current value to a new policy. Now, basically, what I do is, so I start with a random policy, I evaluate that random policy, I'll get a value function corresponding to that policy, then for each set, for basically I get the greedy policy corresponding to this new value function. That means for each state S, set its new policy to be based on the current value function. If it doesn't change, you're done. If nobody's policy changed, nobody's action changed when you read this, then essentially that you are one of those really lucky people and you guessed the optimal policy and you randomly initialize. If not, the policy would have changed at least in some state, and so it's now a new policy by dash. So go back to the loop. Reevaluate the policy's value. Okay? And then compute a new policy that is consistent with that value, that policy's value. It turns out this idea is called policy iteration. This idea is called policy iteration. It too converges. And in fact, it oftentimes converges faster than value function, value iteration. You see what I'm saying? And in fact, another interesting thing is that the policies are only finite number of policies, and so you are likely to be able to go through them much faster than the value. So this is the alternate idea for, MVPs, which is this notion of policy iteration, and it turns out that policy iteration essentially, per step cost of policy iteration is higher because it's solving the value of a policy, which involves solving a whole bunch of linear equations. Except you can reduce it to any amount you want, but just instead of solving the equations, you do updates. So that you push the values closer to what the value of the policy would be. And then you recompute the policy, and then do the value, and the policy, and the value. And if you do this in the terms of the number of steps of iterations taken, policy iteration is faster. Unfortunately, in terms of the time, typically it may not. Another very interesting thing is value iteration turns out to be useful pretty much in every MVP. Okay, whereas policy iteration may or may not actually work for some types of foundations of MVPs. Okay, I am actually going to, I understand if people have to leave. I'm going to just go through this slide because this is important for the homework. So it will be recorded so that at least you will watch this, okay? Because I mean, we don't come back on Monday. So if you have to leave, please feel free, but you know, it will take another 3 minutes. So we have been looking at this particular notation for the MVP. Right? Where essentially you thought of value function in terms of rewards for individual states. The homework actually uses, the homework problems tend to use this, the last one. So the reward one essentially is, you get the reward for a transition, RSAS dash. We talked about this in the beginnings of MVP. The interesting question is, if I'm doing RSAS dash, how does this equation change? All it changes is, instead of RS being outside of this max operation, RS will now go inside. Because remember, the reward you only get after you get to that S dash. SA S dash has a reward. S doesn't have a reward. So the equation that the Bellman update actually looks like this for many of your homework problems.
it will be essentially A B star as A beta times max of A, and you know, instead of just optimizing over maximizing this, you are actually adding RS AS dash for each of those expressions. You have to understand this is basically the same as that. It's just that here S was itself had a reward, here you get a reward for S AS dash. Okay? And there's a slight variation of this, which is actually connected to something that we were saying in the beginning of the class, which is, in fact, instead of rewards, you can think only in terms of tasks. If you think of tasks, then you can think of cost of doing, going from S using action A to S dash. That is C S A S dash. If you're doing cost, the equation almost looks the same, except you don't maximize the cost, you minimize the cost. You see what I'm saying? So instead of the max, you have a min. And just like RSAS dash here, you have CSAS dash here. In fact, this is the formulation that is like hand in glove fit for A star search. Because A star search thinks in terms of cost, this one is completely thinking in terms of cost. And in fact, in some cases, people call this value function as J, they use J instead of V, and they say J is the cost to go. And if you think of cost to go, that's exactly what a heuristic is supposed to be. That's the beginning question of this class. We'll stop here.